Okay, the recording has started. So some general housekeeping. I would really appreciate if you can all have your microphone on mute and your camera turned off during the session. Not because we don't want to hear from you or see you, it's just to make sure that it doesn't blow up the bandwidth and we want the session to be as smooth as possible. There will be a Q&A session at the end where you can ask questions. If you would like to ask questions, please raise your hand. You know that little function or little button at the bottom where you can raise your hand. I will call out your name so you can actually unmute your microphone and actually ask your questions. And if you would like to turn on your camera during that time, you know, that feel free to do so. Please also practice netiquette. Netiquette means online etiquette. Use the chat function only if necessary. We like interactions, but we also don't want it to be too disruptive. Okay, so I will now pass it over to Ms. Sheridan Pierce. She's our industry consultant at the Blue Mountains International Hotel Management School. She will be introducing our guest speaker today. So Sheridan, on to you, and everyone else, please enjoy the session.
Thank you, Miss Cindy. First of all, I just wanted to say thank you so much, everyone. It's wonderful to see 89 students in class today. That is an amazing achievement. So thank you all for being here today. Just to give you a bit of background, as Cindy mentioned, I'm the industry consultant for the school, for those of you that don't know me. And today I've organised for the lovely Ms. Laura Jane Hawkins to chat with you about. She is the Director of Marketing and Communications for the Langham Sydney. She actually did attend as a guest lecturer to our Lura campus last term, and she blew me away with her expertise, her experience, and just her passion for the industry and obviously marketing and communications. And I couldn't pass up the opportunity to invite her to join your class this term as part of Sydney Services Marketing lecture. So without further ado, thank you very much, Laura Jane, for being here again on, you know, an online capacity. Welcome back. And yeah, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me again. It was lovely, as you say, to come in, to actually come to the Blue Mountains a few months ago, which feels, I don't know, it feels like a long time ago or a short time ago, but it was great to be able to see actually the college and the university and to see what all the students do and all different departments. So I really loved it. This is obviously a different experience, talking to you all via Zoom or via the internet, but we'll give it a go. So like you said, I'm here just so I guess I can talk about my job, the what I actually do, about the actual hotel, the brand, and then I guess as well about how I got here and how I got here. So it's all about the Langham. That's like the number one thing, as we can see the logo here at the top. Actually, what's really, really brilliant is that only yesterday, June the 10th, was our 155th anniversary of the Langham London. So, yeah, established in 1865, as you can see there. The Langham London was our first ever hotel. And yesterday, in order to celebrate, we decided to have a 155th afternoon tea. It was actually a virtual afternoon tea party, if you like. So what we did is had all the different, everyone who's my equivalent, everyone who is my counterpart in the different hotels around the world, we all organized live segments and different videos of the people that make the Langham Sydney special or the Langham Melbourne special or the Langham New York special. And we did a whole 24-hour virtual afternoon tea yesterday. Actually, it started at 2 p.m. Sydney time, so probably still, I think we've still got a few hours left. So maybe you might be able to log on after this and catch the end of it. But that was just nice for us to be able to celebrate in that way. So that's myself there. That was actually on my first day at the Langham Sydney, which was the 30th of April 2019. So just over a year I've been there now. And then, yeah, what is my job? Director of Marketing and Communications. Basically, in a nutshell and in one sentence, my job is to make the Langham Sydney even more famous than it already is. And interestingly, when I started the job, I spoke to a lot of people. You'll find out soon where I've been and where I've come from. But I have only been living in Sydney actually just for over a year. So I asked a lot of people, family members, friends that I had here, if they knew much about the Langham Sydney. And even though they do know about Langham as the brand, where the Langham Sydney is based, I don't know if many of you know, but it's by the rocks in the city. And actually, it's always a little bit of a hidden gem. It's in a residential street, all very nice, like beautiful tree lined, and it's lots of locals around, and it's not like right in the centre of the CBD. So a lot of people didn't actually maybe know exactly where it was. So obviously my job is to make it more famous, not just only in Sydney and in Australia, but worldwide. So I have to do as much as I possibly can, and I have to think outside the box all the time, because of course there's all these competitors, other hotels in the city. So if my mum and dad, for example, from England, want to come to Sydney, why is it that they want to come? I've just constantly got to think about why would they choose us at the Langham over others like Four Seasons or Park Hyatt or any of the other sort of top five-star hotels. So that is in a nutshell what my job is. And just high level, what I do on a day-to-day basis, and obviously you've all been doing your marketing course, you'll recognize all of these aspects. And it doesn't look like a lot, but actually it's a lot. Like this job is never ending. I mean, it's absolutely brilliant and I love it, but there's always more you can do. It always goes on, and you think of new ideas, and then you think, oh my goodness, I could do another video, or I could do another advert, or I could do this. So it's all about awareness. Your brand is obviously very, very important. I'm very lucky in the fact that the Langham has got a very strong brand. The Langham pink, I've even got a Langham pen here. Everything is pink and Langham, and there's even the smell. There's a smell, a ginger flower smell that is the Langham smell. What else? Roses, the pink roses are our signature. So all around the world, if any of you have been anywhere, you may have seen the pink roses. So it's all about creating awareness. So of course, everybody nowadays, I think pretty much everybody apart from my great, great uncle in Ireland, is on social media. That is huge. So that is a big, big way for us to get out the brand and the hotel. So via, you know, all the usual things, Facebook and Instagram, and YouTube, I mean, even TikTok now is, of course, really big, especially since COVID. Influencers help us out because people love them and follow them. TikTok, you've got to think about your audience, though. So if I know that TikTok, maybe not so much now, and you can maybe tell me later what your opinions are on TikTok, because since COVID, more and more people have been using it. So older people, all sort of generational. But at the beginning, a few months ago, I might not think to spend so much time on TikTok for the Langham, because people who use TikTok probably would be able to find them anyway. Next, video is huge. My background's in video, so I do love doing video, and we have our own Langham Sydney YouTube channel. Public relations, that takes up a lot of time in this job, and that is all about, really, it's all about networking and building relationships, which is key in any career and any role that you have. But basically inviting journalists and media to the Langham so they can experience it themselves, because then they can write about it in their newspapers, in their magazines, they can do videos. And it's really about building those relationships so that when I do have a new menu coming out, or we are opening a new section of the bar, or whatever it may be, got new treatments in the bar, then I can straight away talk to those journalists that I've got a relationship with and ask them to write the story and cover that. Digital marketing is huge, of course. When you Google anything, you know, you Google best hotel in Sydney, best restaurant in Sydney, I want Langham Sydney to come all the time. So digital marketing is really big with our SEO and our PPC and Google Ads. Also includes the Facebook and social media ads that we pay for to boost as well. Advertising, we've got our e-commerce, that's basically the website. I mean, your website is one of your number one tools. That's one of your number one selling tools, because that's what people look at. You need good content, good photos, good video. Online profiles, if people book a hotel, they go on to booking.com and Expedia. That also needs to be top notch. Events, just people actually experiencing the Langham and coming for events. Word of mouth is obviously massive, and flyers and leaflets. That's pretty old school and old fashioned. But especially somewhere like the Langham Sydney, one of my sort of tactics for post-COVID when we open in a few weeks will be 100% to be, you know, even I might go myself and my team will walk around the local area taking leaflets and talking to the locals, talking to the residents, and actually telling them just in person that the Langham Sydney is back open. So that's like high level what I do for my job first. And of course, if I do all of that correctly, then hopefully the sales team, because obviously you've got the marketing team, and then you've got the sales team who are sitting next to me in the office. And if I do all of those things, then they have got all the tools that they need to actually sell the rooms. And then, of course, we make the money. So there you go. So just going back to, maybe I thought if I talk first a little bit more about myself and the journey to how I got to the Langham, and then I can go more into detail about the marketing for the hotel. So I am from the UK, from England, as I'm sure you can tell by now from my accent. I'm from a place called Bournemouth. I wanted to show you this because I needed to show you this beautiful beach, because people don't think England has nice beaches with sand, but actually we do. We have in Bournemouth, there's a 7 mile sandy beach, which is beautiful sand, no pebbles, no stones, and it is sunny there quite a lot. So there you go. I loved growing up there. It was beautiful. It's amazing. I used to go rollerblading along the beach after school every day, and walk to school along the beach as well. Everything was good. Then I decided that I wanted to be a lawyer. So I wanted to be a barrister, so to wear the actual wig and fight for people's rights, really, like human rights is what I wanted to do. So after a bit of traveling, which you can see a few photos there, I was in India and South America, I did my law degree, and then there I am with my mum and dad on my graduation day. So that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be a lawyer, so that I could human rights and medical law were my two kind of favorite topics at the time. And then I went for dinner with my best friend, and he was my dream. And I said, lawyer. He said, no, there must be something else you want to do. And I was like, why? Lawyer's pretty good. And he said, is there something else that you'd love to do? And I said, you really forced me to answer. I was traveling. I was flying from Fiji to New Zealand. And I remember sitting next to this man on flight. And he was. And this is what's interesting, that sometimes you can just meet people in your life that can change your whole course and your whole destiny, if you like. I was sitting next to him, and he was a war reporter. He'd been in Bosnia, reporting for a UK TV channel and a news channel. And I was really inspired by what he was telling me and what he was talking about. Secretly in my head, I'd love to do that job. But I never told anybody, because I was really scared. I think I didn't feel that I was good enough for it. And it's all that you know. If you're going down one path when you're younger, you feel that everyone just thinks you should stay on that path. And if you go off the path, then you just need to stay on the path and be strong. So I never allowed anybody to know that I wanted to be a TV reporter. But then, because my best friend literally badgered me and bullied me for an answer, I told him. And I ended up doing a master's in broadcast journalism. So I did a master's in the journalism, and it was in broadcast. So that means that you learn how to do radio and you learn how to do TV. And that was for 1 year in London. And then afterwards, I was able to get a job, my first job as a news reporter. So here you are, TV radio reporter here. It was for a channel called British Forces News. So what we did is what did we do? We basically would report on anything the military did, the British military. So if you were in the Army or the Navy or the RAF, we would report on what you were doing, whether you were going, you were training for Afghanistan, you were, I don't know, you might be skiing, doing skiing championships, you might be, it might be family stories, anything. I mean, I traveled, I was very, very lucky. My first job, they posted me to Germany. So I lived in Germany for 2.5 years. And I also did lots of traveling where I'm with the camel. Down there, I was in Jordan, which is beautiful. If you get the chance to go to Jordan, then you should for sure. I also did some presenting, so you can see where I was presenting on the news channel, made lots of documentaries. What else have we got? Interviewed David Beckham there, who was lovely. Go figure. No, he was really nice. Did a lot of stories with amputees. A lot of people, unfortunately, a lot of, you know, the troops lost limbs and lost arms or legs in Afghanistan. So there's a lot of stories which were very, very inspirational about them overcoming their what had happened. And then they just created a new life for themselves. And then, yeah, lots of stories with the royals, with the Queen. Then this one where I'm with the African troops, that was in Mali in Africa. And I mean, lots. Anyway, the point is I did that for 8 years and I really loved it a lot. Like every single day was different. I was in London, I was in Germany and then I moved back to London. And every single morning I would go into work and at 9 o'clock we'd have a news meeting. And then basically it would say, okay, Joanna, you're on this story today. Laura, you're on this story today. You need to go to Manchester. So-and-so, you're on that story today. Or we could come up with our own stories. So I really enjoyed that. And my favorite part was actually when I did get the opportunity to go to Afghanistan to report on the war over there. So I actually somehow, I don't know, I guess lived out my dream of being a war reporter, which I wouldn't have thought when I met that guy on the flight when I was only 18 years old. So but a few years later, I did it. I actually got a medal. So Princess Anne, when you've been to Afghanistan, you've done a tour of duty. I did 3 tours of 3 months each, which is a tour, you get a medal. So that's me very happy at the bottom right or left.
Laura, sorry, Sheridan here. Sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to let you know that I think your connection's a little bit patchy because there are moments where your voice does break up a little bit. I thought it was just me, but I think Cindy's also having the issue.
Okay, let me see if I can tell her. That's strange because usually that should be. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you. It's just there's certain moments where your voice breaks up and then it seems to stabilize and then sometimes it breaks up a little bit again. Just thought I'd let you know.
Okay. Thank you. Let me see. I might be able to try and change. This Wi-Fi usually is good. So let's see. Right. Okay. Well, I was just saying, I mean, that's kind of my 8 years when I was doing my TV reporting, but really this video here is probably a good, you know, highlight reel of what I did. So I think Cindy can play that one.
Yep, just give me a second.
Thank you.
There we go. Okay.
Hello and welcome to Forces News. I'm Laura Hawkins. Hello and welcome to Camp Bastion French Alps here in Leicester Square. Welcome to Mali from the Tower of London and later on today's programme. Well, it's only 125 miles from here, the capital of Estonia, to the Russian border in the east. And whilst I've been here chatting to the Estonians, many of them live their life business as usual. But there is that underlying fear of what may happen if the political situation. Well, I'm here behind the scenes at BBC One's DIY SOS programme. And this right here is the largest project that they've ever undertaken. One man already dead before they got to the hospital, which just shows the lengths that people are going to take that horrendous journey from North Africa, from Libya, to get over onto European soil. Is it therefore not more important to increase maybe the defence budget rather than decrease it? Could you have a word to
Well, what we need to do is make sure we put everything we have in this fight.
2014, I think that's the plan that the
to celebrate what these guys do for us.
Now, what we know from the exercise scenario so far is that HMS
troops are there, and how long are they supposed to be there for?
Well, of course, 13 years we were in Afghanistan, so the end of international.
That will take about 1 hour, 1.5 hours.
I'm the teacher. This will be a literature.
Calls for mastiffs, jackals, deployed back to the UK. But first of all, they've got to come here to the vehicle replenishment section.
Without a doubt, this is an impressive facility with sports and classes for the young men here. But at the end of the day, they are prisoners, and some may ask if they really deserve and need a centre like this. You're just happy that you're here now?
Yeah, I'm just happy. That's all. So I've got to live a better life down here. That's all.
Now that the armed forces aren't in the media as much because of operations coming home, how do you think they will stay in the public eye? How important is that?
I think it's vital.
It's late afternoon here now, and there's still no sign of military boots on the ground here today. We heard the alarm go off, the IDF alarm, and then only a few seconds later, I heard what I can only describe as three thuds outside. Of course, we then took the necessary precautions and the drills. We got to the floor, put on our body armour and waited for instructions. Russia is reported to have sent more aircraft and two tank landing ships to Syria.
Hello, Laura. What more can you tell us?
It's absolutely shocking, this report, revealing all of the CIA's darkest secrets over the last decade. The report is actually 6,700 pages long. It's taken years to compile. Scotland have made their decision. They've rejected independence and voted to stay with the United Kingdom. And this weather that we've got here right now is the most challenging.
Laura Hawkins, Forces News, Helmand.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Oh,
you
good.
Are
good.
Back on. I'll just take you back to that slide you were at before.
Thank
Is this
you.
A slide?
You... Yes, please.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Melissa. the video just, I don't know, it's just an easier way to really show, because 8 years is quite a long time, so it's hard for me to remember everything. So it's just a good way to show just a bit of variety of what I was able to do, which was really, really cool. Everything was really great. But then what happened is I thought to myself, do you know what? Actually, I'm going to be honest. I actually wanted to live here in Australia because I just bought the country. So I'm over here. And thank you for your messages. That's very kind. And so I came over here and to Australia, and I thought I'll be a TV reporter over here. But actually, on the way, I basically was introduced to somebody who had a charity in the Philippines. And I spoke to him and he said, would you like to come over here in the Philippines and work with me for a little while on what we're doing? And I thought, you know what, I would absolutely love that, because I did a little bit of charity work in India when I was 19, but I hadn't actually worked properly. That was just some volunteering. So I thought I'd be really, you know, it'd be a really, really good experience. So I ended up going to some of you probably may be from the Philippines or you know the Philippines. It's a little island off Cebu called Bantayan. And it's so beautiful. It's absolutely lovely. But unfortunately, in 2013, so much of the country was devastated by Typhoon Haiyan or Yolanda, and especially some of the islands around Cebu just got completely and utterly wiped out. And I mean, all of the homes and the families just lost their homes, as you can see. And I mean, I could have put so many pictures up, but you can see that. So this charity called YPDR, called Young Pioneer Disaster Response, they decided to build these typhoon resistant houses. So you can see on the bottom right hand side, these are the actual houses, And I went there to work with a team, and my job, really my job was kind of media officer, if you like. So I would create videos and take photos, do a lot of social media. And I was thinking of it at the time, I was working there as a journalist. That's what I was thinking, because that's all I knew. I only knew myself as a journalist. But actually, the more I worked there, the more I realized without even realizing, was that I was moving into marketing, really, and PR, because everything I was doing, I was marketing the charity and trying to get more awareness of the charity so that more and more people would support us, more people would donate money, more people would be interested in what we were doing. So that's really how I accidentally started moving into the whole marketing and PR, because, you know, there's a lot of crossover. I'm hoping you can hear me, crackling, and I'm not breaking up again. I'll just count. Sheridan, you can tell me if you have issues.
You are breaking up slightly, to be honest with you. But I mean, I can still understand you. Can the class hear you okay? I don't know if it's just either myself or Cindy. Can anyone else confirm? Just in the chat box is fine. Okay.
I think it's breaking a little bit, but people can still make up the sentence with the missing bits. It's okay, Laura. It's part and parcel of online delivery.
Exactly.
It's understandable.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Okay. And then secondly, as well as building the new houses, what they did is, thankfully we have pictures, this is good. What they did is, we also did some marine conservation work. So because of the typhoon, believe it or not, a lot of the marine life got wiped as well. So, and it's so important, of course, as we all know, the marine life, especially in the Philippines. So we built these, what you can see in the picture, they're called marine domes. And what they do is we dropped them into the ocean in a special area, in like a farm marine dome area. And it just means that wildlife have somewhere, because all of the coral got wiped, they didn't have the fish and the plant life didn't have anything to grow and reproduce and actually stay safe. So these marine domes also did that. So I worked there for about 6 months in the Philippines, and it was brilliant. I loved it. Please go to the Philippines. It's my favorite country, one of my favorites. Then I decided that I really actually liked the PR and marketing. So I was able to get a job then in the Maldives. And you can see there how beautiful it is. It was a brand new resort called Candima. So when I moved onto the island, it was like a building site. It was completely like no aircon, which isn't even that bad. I don't even like aircon. No kind of real like facilities, no hotel wasn't built, the resort wasn't built. So it was a really good experience because I saw everything being built, all the water villas. There were 10 different F&B outlets there. We had a beach club. We had the biggest kids club in the Maldives. We had a Chinese restaurant. We had a live music venue. So for the Maldives, we called it the new Maldives because it was completely different to anything that we'd had before. And yet again, I have a video because it's easier to, as we know, marketing, video is king, really. So it's easier to explain it in the video. This video, before Cindy plays it, is actually one of the best things I think I did at Candima in the 18 months I was there for the marketing. So we did a competition where you could win a flight. I partnered with Turkish Airlines, gave us some flights, or gave me some flights from anywhere in the world to go to the Maldives. So I could make it a worldwide competition. And it's this video that you'll see here. And to enter, you had to share the video and like and tag. And we got a lot. It went really, really well. And I think Cindy can play the video now. That's okay.
Yep, here we go.
Thank you.
So I hope maybe that makes some of you want to go to Kandima, hopefully, because it's more fun. It's a much more, it's a much more fun place, because a lot of people think that Maldives is just a honeymoon destination, because that's what people think. But Kandima was a family resort. It was more fun. You could just go with your girlfriends if you wanted, or you could go with a group of friends. It was much cheaper as well, because we had apartments on the beach, not just beach villas. So it was all about, for me, that was all about trying to target a different audience, a different audience for the Maldives. So I had to then think, okay, people usually will advertise for Maldivian holiday in luxury magazines or very high-end newspapers, where people who can really afford it or who are going on their honeymoon, their once-in-a-lifetime trip, that's where you would market. But I actually ended up doing the opposite and ended up marketing in just everyday newspapers that everybody was reading, because if they could look at it and say, wow, I didn't know you could go to the Maldives for only $300 a night instead of $1,000 a night, they actually would look, they'd come on our website, they'd come on our social media, and we went from there. So I did that for 18 months, and then, which was yet again an amazing experience. The only thing about Maldives is, if you work on a resort, some of you might want to work in Maldives in the future, definitely say to go for it, but you will just be on an island, on the resort, on an island. It's not like working in Bali or Thailand. So after 18 months, it's a good time to move. Then I moved to Hong Kong, and I worked for Overlow Hotels, which I'm sure some of you also know. And I was working, there's a couple of, they have four hotels in Hong Kong, two in Australia. So I had a good time working. And they're a very fun brand to work for, but really I wanted to be in Australia. So I came back to Australia, I really wanted to go to Sydney, and then got my job that I've got now at the Langham. So there you go, that's from all the way through to today. Now we can talk a little bit more about, I don't know what time, what time I've got, but anyway, I'll carry on. So the Langham, we have got 17 hotels worldwide. We have got quite a few in the US, as you can see there. Our first was in London, as I mentioned earlier. Munich is opening soon in Germany. We have got a lot of hotels in China. We've got a couple in Hong Kong. And then we have got the Langham Sydney, the Langham Melbourne. And then only last week, I sent out a press release to everybody in Australia about our new hotel, which is opening on the Gold Coast at the end of next year, end of 2021. It's been a little bit delayed. So just here's some different photographs of the Langham all over the world. Some of you may have been to some of these hotels already, and hopefully some of you would like to work for the Langham soon after you have graduated. And then the Langham has also got like a sister hotel in a way, which is called Cordis. So we've got our Cordis in Auckland. We've got a few Cordis hotels in China as well. So the vision is a global hospitality group that pursues excellence. Oh, great. Harrison James worked at the Langham London. That's brilliant. I went there for the first time for one night last year, and it was really beautiful. So the Sydney mission is, every hotel has their own mission. So the Sydney mission is that it's expectations in a sophisticated retreat within a charming Sydney harbourside community. And then we've got this Melbourne mission. We extend intuitive service with poise and Langham luxury, which builds lasting Melbourne memory. Now, our brand is obviously very, very important. You would have learned that from all of your marketing lectures that you've had and marketing tutorials. Taking initiative is one main brand kind of guidelines or pillars, if you like. And what taking initiative means is take the lead to do the right thing without being told. So because you can make a difference, and taking ownership. So you will see from, and you'll know from working and learning about hospitality, that every single department of hospitality, all of us can take initiative all the time. And it is actually really nice stories, and we very much encourage our front office staff to let us know, let the marketing team know about stories where the front office staff or concierge or the F&B staff have taken initiative and, you know, they've done something a little bit more out of the ordinary. These are some of the stories. I don't think I've got time really to go through them because I'm going to talk more about marketing. This is just really about the Langham, but it's just stories where people have really, it's about being full and doing something nice and really giving the guest an exceptional service, an exceptional experience, but we've got to exceed the expectation. I think that's what the Langham is all about, because the Langham, if you go to the Langham, it's a 5-star hotel, and we won Australia's best boutique hotel last year. So we are number one boutique hotel in Australia. So your expectation to come to the Langham is already going to be really high because of these things. But what you've got to think, or what we've got to think, is we've got to exceed that even more. So that's how high the service is. We are number 4 out of 200 hotels in Sydney on TripAdvisor. We're hoping to get to number 1 very, very soon. And our views are from our guests, Forever Young, Better Every Day, Celebrate Success, Social Responsibility, One Team Dream, Integrity, and I guess this is my one, communicate, communicate, communicate. So we have quite a few values, and anything, you know, to do with marketing, it's got to be, the brand has got to be strong and the values have got to be strong to have that base to then get it out to worldwide. And sorry, I just passed that. Basically, our goal, my goal, is to promote all of the Langham's outlets. So we have the restaurant right at the top here. We have our restaurant Kitchens on Kent, which is a buffet restaurant. We have obviously the beautiful suites. We have weddings. We have the spa. We have the beautiful pool, which you can see at the bottom. And we've got the observatory bar. So all of those different outlets, I have to do marketing plans for each one and decide on what the budget that I have, what the best way to spend that budget to get the word out there. And yet again, Cindy can play. Do any of you, have any of you been watching MasterChef, by the way? And because there's a girl called Tessa on there at the moment, she's in the last 10, and she actually is one of our ambassadors and did a video with us, which I'd show you, but if no one watches it, you probably watch it, maybe. But what we can do, Cindy, maybe you could play the Langham video.
So MasterChef one or the one on the left first?
The one on the left, I think. This is the Langham. This is just, I mean, all, you know, really good in all marketing, you know, to have a strong brand video. And this is actually ours for the Langham as a whole, the Langham.
Okay. All right, I'll pull that one up now.
Thank you.
Okay, no worries.
That's the video, which is kind of, they've last year they decided to do a little bit more of a new ad, which is like the everyday, fun and playful. So that comes across, I think, definitely more fun and playful than maybe people think of the moment. It is very you can still have fun and be yourself at the same time. Now, as well as the Langham Sydney, my job actually, since I've started, opened up at the Langham Sydney. It's called Kitchens on Kent, and it's a, wow. And it's got 8 different kitchens, all cooking different things. So what I think we might do is link, if that's okay, Cindy, and that will just give everyone an idea of what my life has been for the last year. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can, sorry. I'm just trying to work this out from the other tab. Okay, here we go.
Thank you. Oh, this one is the, actually this one. Okay, you can play this one.
Did I get the wrong one? Maybe this one.
I'm just worried about time. You might want to, this one might be a bit long.
Okay, would you prefer the other one?
Yes, please, yeah.
Okay.
This is on my YouTube channel, so if anyone really desperate to see it.
Sorry, just to clarify, is it the kitchen one or the MasterChef one?
The kitchen one, please.
Yeah. Okay. Here we go.
So that's Kitchens on Kent. That's the restaurant I was talking about. And a lot of my job as the marketing and PR has been to invite journalists and influencers and KOLs into the restaurant to experience the restaurant and then to write about it, put it on social media. I've had to do a lot of, I've even done radio ads. I actually voiced a radio ad myself on Smooth FM and Smooth Radio and on The Edge. So I did that. Social media is huge for us on all different channels. So if any of you, obviously, I would like all the followers I can get. So if you can follow us, if you want to, you can. And you'll probably see myself and the team coming up on Insta stories quite a bit. And what else have we got? I mean, this is just really a snapshot of a lot of the coverage we saw for Kitchens on Kent. So a lot of different... a lot of different media, from hospitality, which is and everything from Time Out to Concrete Ground to the Sunday Telegraph, the Battle of the Buffet, lots of reviews. And yeah, I mean, it just goes on. We do a lot of advertising for the bar and the spa. And then what I do is, as much as possible, because of my background, I try to do video. So the Pussycat Dolls, for example, came to stay with us at the Langham. And they came to stay because they were on, they were promoting their own tour. And, you know, they paid them, you know, completely paid for it. They weren't there complimentary, but they agreed to do an interview with me. So I had an interview with them in our lobby. So that's just a really good way. If you can ever have influencers or celebrities, then just a good way to leverage off their followers, of course. So when I put that on YouTube, we got a lot of interest. And then really, it's just about now, my job is to plan the reopening. So we open on the 1st of July, and what we're going to do is a competition. So we've got 3 new staycation packages, and we're going to launch a competition that if you buy one of these staycation packages, you can go in the draw. There's a couple of other things you need to do as well. But then if you win, you will win a 1-night Langham for you and your plus one, plus 20 of your friends and family. So it's a pretty huge prize. You get one night stay at the Langham with everybody. You get a four-course private dinner by our executive chef. You get a couple of hours in the bar complimentary with a bespoke cocktail list and canapes. A 60-minute massage treatment each and lots and lots of amazing things. So I thought that if we do an amazing prize, if you want to treat your family, say you want to treat your mum and dad to a nice day in Sydney, then if you're looking at the Four Seasons, looking at Park Hyatt and you're looking at the Langham Sydney, and you're thinking, okay, they're all similar price for me to stay there for the night. But if I buy at the Langham Sydney, then I can go in for, you know, go into the competition to win a night with 20 of my friends. I'm hoping that, I'm really excited because you've got a little bit of a sneak peek there because I'm not launching it until Monday, but I'm hoping that this will really boost some sales for us because of course with the borders closed still, international guests are huge for us and corporate guests are really big for us and corporates aren't traveling either. You know, those from Melbourne aren't coming to Sydney and from Hong Kong, from New Zealand. So right now I need to focus on the domestic market. That's what I need to focus on. So hopefully that will be a great incentive for people. And also Pampered Pets. We are one of the only hotels. In Sydney that allows pets, dogs, cats, birds, parrots, gerbils. So we are going to really, I think that's something that I thought about and I think it would be a really good thing to boost yet again for the domestic market because at the moment people have, you know, they save money, they've been inside lockdown and they might just want a day and want to bring their dog along as well. So we are going to waiver the fee of any pets. Usually it's $120 per dog to come as well, extra, but we're going to waiver that fee and I'm really, really going to push that dogs and cats are welcome at the Langham as well. And then of course, we've got to remember that post-COVID is all about how things are gonna change. So it's about our safety and our well-being of the guests and how extra sanitizer, precautions, extra measures are gonna be taken by the operational staff, you know, concierge, gonna be wearing gloves and doormen, extra cleaning, asked if you want your room changed, if you want to be shown to your room, all extra measures need to be taken. And that is pretty much it from me, unless there's any questions.
Thanks, Laura. I will be mailing the questions. So if you have any questions, just raise your hand. We have one from Regina. So Regina, if you would like to unmute yourself, show your camera so you can say hello to our speaker if you'd like to and ask your question.
Hello. Sorry, my camera doesn't really work. But I wanted to thank you so much for the presentation. It was really inspiring, Laura. You got a new customer and follower over here.
Thank you. That's really kind of you.
So first of all, based on your experience in the Philippines and in the Maldives, what would you recommend to someone who wants to go and work in a country in Asia Pacific, but is concerned about the pay rate and, you know, the lifestyle and how you sustain yourself in a country, like a third world country, basically, in compared to Australia that we are kind of already used to.
I mean, it depends what you like. I mean, I like living in those countries and I like the lifestyle and I like it that it's not, you know, it's not as, I guess, it's not as safe, but you don't have all the backup, I guess, as you might do in Australia. But if you work for a good hotel brand, you're definitely, I mean, as far as I had the experience, you're still very much well looked after. I mean, when I lived in the Maldives and worked in the Maldives, they pay for everything's included. So all your food, your accommodation, the pay, you don't get tax actually. So from my personal experience, actually in the Maldives, I felt very, you know, the package you get and everybody who I worked with, you do get well looked after in the fact of the medical, you know, you get a special visa, you get medical cover, you get all of your food. Actually, I mean, a lot of my friends, that's where they were able to save the most money, because when you're somewhere like the Maldives, you're not really, you're getting the experience of your career and your work and your job, and that is your main focus. You're not going off and doing so many social things. So actually, for me as well, that's probably where I save the most money, and my colleagues as well. So the Philippines was different because that was an independent charity, and that was very much, you know, I had to have my own savings really, and then just trust that it would be okay medical wise. But if you're in hospitality and you decide to go for a, you know, work for the Marriott or Accor or Minor Group or the Langham, you will be looked after. So I would just look into it. And there's some really, really good websites. I can't think of them now, but there's some really, really good websites where you can find those jobs in those different countries. I would recommend something like somewhere like Maldives. I think it's great.
Thanks,
awesome. Thank you so much for your answer.
That's okay.
Up next, we have a question from Harrison, and Harrison is the one who actually worked at the Langham Sydney. Harrison, if you would like to unmute yourself, please.
Hi, Laura. Yeah, as I mentioned before, I worked over in London, not Sydney. But yeah, so I was over there at the start of this year on part of my placement, but have had to come home because of everything. And when I was over there, I did a couple of days in the like sales and marketing department, just as I was in my orientation week. What I was wanting to ask is it difficult to market to the Pacific type of market while staying within the Langham brand itself? Or what kind of challenge marketing with the Sydney properties compared to the properties in Asia and over London and America?
Yeah, I personally only have to market, thankfully, the Langham Sydney. I don't actually have to market those in London or other hotels around the world. But I think that because the brand is, because the whole brand is quite strong, I mean, I don't know, it's a difficult one for me to answer really, because I don't have to market the other hotels. So I'm not sure if they might find it more difficult to market in this, like the Asia region, for London versus Sydney. I'm not sure, what is that what you're asking? If there's like different challenges from each different property around the world?
Yeah, or basically, like, I don't know, just with people having expectations of the Langham brand, and if they've stayed within different properties and stuff, what kind of challenges are there to draw them into like staying in Sydney rather than being like under the whole Langham brand kind of thing?
Okay, because the Langham London is very, I know what you're saying. The Langham London is very grand, and it's very 1965, it's very old and worldly and very traditional. And then of course, the Langham Melbourne is quite different, and the Langham Sydney is different. So I think that, I think it's making sure people expectations are met and set at the beginning. So when, for example, if you booked a room with us, one of my jobs is to make sure that when we've applied to you and when you've made your booking, you have, or even in the conversation with the reservation agents, that you have all the information. And then, like, you know, you can see a link to the video, you can see a link to our gallery and photos and our TripAdvisor, so that you understand that really, as you're saying, it's not as if, it's not a cookie cutter. You know, the Langham isn't a cookie cutter in the fact that single Langham around the world is identical. They are slightly different, and they are got their unique character. So as long as I think that I, the Langham Sydney, get that unique character out, that it's a, you know, in a residential street, it's off the beaten track, it's only 10-minute walk to the opera, only a 5-minute walk to the city, and really explain the setting. then we don't generally have any issues, actually, people coming to the Langham Sydney and feeling that it's not the same as the Langham London or anything like that. So I think we're quite lucky there.
Yeah, that's good. Very lucky with the brand itself. I've got another little quick question as well. Sure. With this new competition that you've got for Sydney, are you planning to market that solely over social media, or what was the kind of marketing plan for releasing the campaign and stuff like that?
That's great you asked me, because I didn't have time to talk about it, but I want to talk about it. So my plan is a press release, which straight away I'm hoping that journalists will love it, because it is a really cool prize. So I'm hoping that journalists are on it. Also, I'm hoping that really post-COVID, people and contacts I've made, like I said before, they're going to want to support the Langham. PR, public relations and press release, and getting that out, the word out there. Number two is, if you remember the video, yesterday I was actually in the edit suite, because I've got a colleague who is helping me out. So I was in the edit suite with him, and what I've created, you'll see it if you follow us on social and follow us for Monday, I've created like a similar video, which is of the Langham Sydney, and it has a similar, you know, graphics over the top, because I really feel like video is king. Like, video is the thing that people, you know, just quick can see it, gets in their brain. So I'm doing a video as well, and then what we'll do is we'll do some boosting on Facebook and on the Facebook and on the Instagram. I'll also have the video on YouTube. We're also going to do some SEO, actually. So, and we're going to, because the competition runs until the end of December, or the 13th of December. So it actually allows me to do things like Google Ads and SEO, where you can Google search, and because the competition is so long. Also, on the website, I've changed the website so that when you go on the website from Monday, it will actually come up with Enter Australia's Most Luxurious Staycation Competition. And I have got some, yeah, I mean, I haven't yet, but I have got some radio that got paused before COVID-19. So possibly, thank you, Cindy, yes, possibly I could use the radio, actually. So yeah, you've made me think of that. Thank you. I could possibly use the radio and think, and, you know, say, book the Langham, one of the staycation packages, and you can win a holiday for you and 20 of your friends. I think that I want to, it's very competitive, as we know. Post-COVID is going to be tough for everybody in the city. So I just really want to get this competition and the press release and video out. And you've got to be strong, you know, as soon as you have something that is good, you've got to, on Monday and Tuesday, I'm literally going to be like, push, 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 push. All contacts I know, all influencers I know, all travel writers I know, I'm going to be asking them to share it on their social, asking them just for support to get the word out there.
Awesome. Thank you so much for answering that for me.
Pardon? Are you there, Harrison? Oh.
Yeah, I just dropped out. I was just saying thank you for answering those questions. Yeah, it's very helpful, and I'm sure it's helpful to everyone else as well. But yeah, thank you very much.
I'll just finish as well, just quickly, with what I'm going to do with local marketing is I've written, it's called the Local Resident Guide. So it's a little bit like a newsletter. And even though it's really old school, I think that the local residents will really appreciate it. And like I said, I'm going to walk around with this newsletter, delivering it to the locals around the local area, because I really feel that they can, you know, tell their friends. And it's going to be very much, this competition will be a word of mouth as well. And if they know that, if their family who live down in Wollongong want to come to, and they might say, you know what, you should book a room in the Langham down the road, because you're then going to be able to enter this competition. So hopefully word of mouth will be a big one as well.
Thanks, Laura. We have three more questions, but I'm also aware we've passed the 12 o'clock mark. Would you have time to take these questions?
I'm fine with time. I'm good.
Okay, thank you. Next up, we have Brenny. Brenny, do you want to unmute yourself, please?
Yes, hello, Miss Laura Jane.
Hello.
I just want to know, and this is not the marketing part question, but I just want to know if this Langham Sydney reopens in July, will the worker who is currently working there will get back their job, like all of the casual, full-time, part-time?
So I don't know how it's going to work. I think what's going to happen is we won't have the occupancy, of course, that we had before we closed. So I think what will happen is that we'll be brought back, but it will just be very staggered. So it will just depend on the F&B manager, for example, who he brings in, or the kitchen staff. It will be up to the executive chef who and how he brings back the kitchen staff. So we're actually, I'll bring them back, but it's very difficult for me to answer that for everybody else. All I know is it's going to be staggered coming back. Everybody that was working before will be staggered coming back, but I don't know how long it will be. It's so difficult to, still difficult, even though we're opening, someone can come back all at once because we won't have the occupancy.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Brenny, and thanks, Laura. Next, we have Durendra.
Hi, Miss Laura.
Hello.
I'll just make this for people who want to like enter like the marketing world and like want to pursue a career in marketing. What would you say would be some key characteristics that they should hold? Succeed.
You just dropped out there a little bit. Sorry. So what? Just repeat the last part.
For people who want to enter the marketing world and like pursue a career in marketing, what would you say would be some key characteristics that they should hold?
I think you have to be, maybe it sounds a little bit much, but I think you have to be you have to really believe in what you're doing and be a bit of a fighter, really. I think that's with myself, even though I haven't gone down the traditional route of doing a marketing degree and going to hospitality college as you all are, I think that I'm a good fighter. And I think about, okay, constantly think about myself as the guest. So if I am looking for a holiday or a hotel room, what is it that I want to see? And then as the marketing director, I'm just fighting all the time and just having a lot of persistence and a lot of creativity in your thinking, really, in your thinking about how people will see you, how people will hear you, how people talk about you. You need to be a very positive person, because of course your network all the time, that's 40% of the job, networking and meeting people. So just being quite positive and bubbly, believing in what you're actually marketing, and just having a lot of persistence is what I would giving somebody an interview. I just want to see somebody who really has drive. That's what I'm looking for because if you know, skills are brilliant and what you're learning is great, but really it's about someone you can work with, be a good team player, and just think of as many different things as you can to get the name out there.
That's brilliant. Thanks, Miss.
You're welcome.
Okay, next we have Mailing.
Yes, thank you, Miss Cindy. Good afternoon, Miss Laura. How are you doing today?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for asking. I just got a quick question. Maybe it's quite similar to Dorindra, but yeah, it's just like in relation to a requirement that would be needed for entering a marketing team. So what would you say, maybe like criteria or knowledge that would be suitable to be part of a marketing team?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I would definitely say everything you just said in your attitude, I would definitely say, okay, say any of you are coming now to me because I need somebody in the team. Really, what I'm looking for is somebody with like positivity. I know they've got energy, but also really social media is so, can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you okay.
It really is huge, and it will continue to be huge. So I would I really need somebody who's very, very savvy on social media and actually enjoys it. I think you have to enjoy it. Social media, when you're working out, can actually be, if I'm honest, a bit of a chore to have to get Insta stories, to have to do posts all the time, to have to think do posts, Insta videos. So just as much kind of social media experience you have is good. Also nowadays, just on your mobile phone, you know, filming, doing videos on your mobile phone, if you can really learn how to do videos on your mobile phone and start editing little videos, that is so, so helpful for anybody in any manager, marketing manager. If they can interview somebody and they say, yeah, I do these little videos on my phone, 10-second videos, 20-second videos, 30-second videos, that is like a dream, because there's so many things that happen in the hotel and they might only be little things, but if I can get them up on social media or on YouTube and they're 20, 30-second videos, and I have somebody who can do that, who likes doing it, that also is a massive plus. Yeah, just kind of, I mean, sometimes it's actually, you know, redoing menus, a lot of menus, flyers, and just having ideas, really. But social media and video, I say, would be the two great things that I would look for if I was in somebody for an internship or a coordinator role or a executive role.
I see. Sorry, I got one more question as well. So in terms of sales and marketing like department, because like for my point of view, I would say sales and marketing work together, but actually in real life they are different. Am I correct? And what are the jobs that they're doing, because they're quite different from each other, sales and marketing?
Yes, that's correct. So as well as really in the team where I am, I just have to make sure in the marketing department, we prepare and design and create all the assets that the sales team, it's like all the sales team need to go out and sell the rooms. So for example, we have got a director of corporate sales, and she goes out and speaks to people like all the big banks, all the big, you know, airlines, all the big insurance companies and finance companies. And if they are doing, if they're in Melbourne and they are having a conference in Sydney, she'll go and speak to them and say, do you know what, the Langham Sydney is the place to be. And they go, yep, okay, great. There's 200, well, it's only a 96 bedroom hotel, but say there's like 70 of us, we'll stay for 3 nights. Now, in order to sell to the banks and to the finance companies, she needs a really good deck, like a really good presentation to show this is why you need to stay with us and you shouldn't stay with Four Seasons or you shouldn't stay with them. So that's my job, to create the really, really good deck and the really good videos and the really good content, so she has as much as she can to actually sell the rooms and get the business. So we are very different. She's out on the road talking to people or bringing people in to sell the rooms, where I'm actually creating the tools for her.
I see, great. So thank you so much for answering my question. That has been very helpful to me, and hope you have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you, you too.
Thank you.
Thanks, Laura. We have one last question, if we have the time to fit it in. Regina,
Yeah, sorry, Laura. One more question popped into my head. Okay. So looking at the future, what do you think is the next marketing strategy coming up? You know that right now, obviously, we're holed up with influencers, social media is the main thing. But coming up into the future, is there anything marketers are looking forward to as a new method of marketing, or are they holding up to what it is going on now?
Oh, I can hear my feedback then. Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Because with all of COVID, and even the influencers haven't been able to travel, haven't had the content they're used to. But then again, TikTok TikTok has been huge. So that's something that, like I said before, you've got to look at the audience that use these outlets and these profiles. So before, TikTok was all very much just like the younger generation. You know, even my nephew, you know, he's on TikTok all the time. But now actually all generations TikTok because of COVID, and people have started using it a lot more. But then that's more, and yeah, again, you've got to think about what you're selling or what you're marketing. So I've got the Langham Hotel as an expensive high-end hotel, but then I've also got the restaurant, which is a buffet restaurant in Sydney. So I could now start, I haven't used TikTok before, but I could now start thinking, you know what? What I might do, people in Sydney might be using TikTok, and I think they are. So I could get some of the chefs to do funny dances, funny meals, and I don't know, whatever the, you know, crazy stuff is that they do. And maybe not for the hotel because it's so expensive per night. So not everybody who uses TikTok would be able to afford it. But actually, to see these funny chefs and dancing chefs, maybe TikTok could be a good platform for that, because more people seeing those chefs being silly in the kitchen, they might say, you know what, I want to go to that buffet. I want to try that pizza, or I want to try that tandoor bread or that naan bread. So there's always these different avenues you've got to look at, but you've got to really research and look at whether it's worth the time. Apart from that, I mean, it's still old school actual journalists, you know, writing in papers and online is just still really what I go for. I'm just trying to think. And really video, I mean, still video is where people are. Nowadays, Google Ads, people aren't, I mean, I've done it myself, haven't actually used Google Ads as much. I've used video ads because it does capture people's attention and they'll click, and obviously you get their attention for a whole 20 seconds or 30 seconds, whatever it may be. So for me, it's definitely still about video, and then it's just about rebuilding the contacts after COVID. Really, nothing massively new about or seen so far, but you never know.
Right, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you so much, everyone, for your questions, and Laura for being here with us today. We are 18 minutes past the time, but I'm really grateful you are so willing to take the questions. So,
I talk too much. That's why. So thanks for staying on the line.
No, that's fine. I mean, you've got so much to share, and I think everyone else just wanted to hear more. This was all very interesting for me, and I can see our students have also been very inspired. Thank you for sharing your life with us before and after the Langham Sydney. Thank you too for answering the myriad of questions from our students, from marketing strategies to employment post-COVID, and also, you know, characteristics required from someone in your role. I think some for our students who are very close to graduation, or maybe, you know, undertaking their next placement, this is really important information to them. So I think for all of us, we can appreciate that this has been a really hectic period for Miss Laura. She's preparing for the opening. Nevertheless, she's been so generous with her time today. So thank you very much for your time. And we typically give a big round of applause to our speaker in the classroom, but obviously doing it online is a lot more difficult. So I've tried to be a little bit creative, and that's my round of applause to you.
Oh, thank you. That's really great. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Laura.
You're welcome, everybody. Thanks, everyone. Good luck with your work, your exams, and everything you have coming up. And I'll see you another time. Oh.
Sorry. Thank you. Messages coming through the chat. So yeah, take your time to read it if you'd like. And everyone, please join the competition.
Mia, thank you so much, Laura. We really do appreciate your time. I know and appreciate that you must be very busy ramping up to reopen the Langham. And obviously this is your second term in a row chatting with our students. So thank you. We really do appreciate it and appreciate your time.
No, you're very welcome. And thank you for all the... Thank you, everybody. That's awesome. Thank you. And I'll speak to you soon anyway.
Perfect.
Take care. Bye, everyone.
Take care.
Thank you again.
Have a good day, everybody.